Hello, Vital Sign. Today we're going to talk about King's graphs. An n by k King's graph is a type of graph whose vertices represent squares on an n by k chessboard and whose edges represent all possible legal moves of a king on a chessboard. Every connection between two vertices in a king's graph represents a legal move of a king between the squares represented by those two vertices. For those unfamiliar with chess, a king can move one square in any direction from its current square. Moving on, we are familiar with the 8x8 chessboard, and the legal moves of a king on this chessboard would be captured by an 8x8 king's graph. However, king's graphs can have different dimensions as well, such as 3x5, 6x7, any pair of positive whole numbers, really. In graph theory terms, an n by k King's graph is defined as the strong product of a path graph with n vertices with a path graph with k vertices. For example, a 3x4 King's graph is the strong product of a 3-vertex path graph with a 4-vertex path graph. I recommend you watch my video on strong products of graphs if you haven't already, as strong products will be very important in this video. Using our new definition, the King's graph corresponding to our typical 8x8, 64-square chessboard is the strong product of two path graphs with 8 vertices each. Now let's look at why a strong product of two path graphs produces a graph that captures the legal moves of a king on a chessboard. Picture a chessboard where we label the rows with numbers 1 through 8. And we label the columns with letters A through H. If our king is stationed at B1, then it can move to squares in the same row but in an adjacent column, that is C1 and A1, or it can move to squares in the same column but in an adjacent row, that is B2, and it can move to squares in both an adjacent column and an adjacent row, that is A2 and C2. That means that for a king's graph, where each square is represented by a vertex, the vertex representing square B1 should have connections to A1, C1, B2, A2, and C2. The key concept here is that a king can move side to side one step, up and down one step, and diagonal one step. If a king's graph is to capture the structure of the legal moves of a king on a chessboard, any two vertices defined by an ordered pair x1, y1, and x2, y2, where x's are their column letters and y's are their row numbers, will connect if they have the same column letter and consecutive row numbers. That is, x1 equals x2, and y1 and y2 are consecutive numbers. Or if they have the same row number and consecutive letters, that is, y1 equals y2 and x1 and x2 are consecutive letters. Or finally, they will connect if the two vertices have consecutive row numbers and consecutive column letters. That is, x1 and x2 are consecutive letters and y1 and y2 are consecutive numbers. Doesn't this definition of ordered pairs remind you of the strong product of two graphs, where each vertex in the strong product represents an ordered pair of vertices from the factor graphs? And does our idea of connecting vertices that are in adjacent columns but the same row, or in adjacent rows but the same column, or in adjacent rows and adjacent columns remind you of the adjacency conditions of strong products of graphs? If these concepts feel similar, it's because they are, as we'll cover right now. Think of the strong product of two path graphs on 8 vertices, one labeled with letters A through H and the other labeled with numbers 1 through 8. As we learned in previous videos, the strong product of these two graphs will have 64 vertices, each corresponding to an ordered pair of vertices from the path graphs. According to the first adjacency rule for strong products, highlighted in yellow, two vertices in the strong product are connected if the first entries in their ordered pairs, in this case their letters, are the same vertex in the first graph, and if their second entries in their ordered pairs, in this case their numbers, are adjacent vertices in the second graph. In this case, consecutive numbers or vertices in the second graph are adjacent, which means that all strong product vertices with the same letter and consecutive numbers will connect to each other. This means that each vertex in a column will connect to the vertices one step above and one step below it in that column. This is precisely the property we're looking for in a King's graph, where vertices in the same column but adjacent rows should connect, corresponding to an up and down movement of a king on a chessboard. According to the second adjacency rule for strong products of graphs, two vertices in the strong product are connected if their second entries in their ordered pairs, in this case their numbers, are the same vertex in the second graph, and their first entries in their ordered pairs, in this case their letters, are adjacent vertices in the first graph. In this case, consecutive letters or vertices in the first graph are adjacent, which means that all strong product vertices with the same number and consecutive letters will connect to each other. This means that each vertex in a row will connect to the vertices one step to the right and one step to the left in that row. This is exactly the property of a king's legal moves, where a king can travel to any square in an adjacent column but in the same row. Finally, according to the third adjacency rule, two vertices in the strong product are connected if their first entries in their ordered pairs are adjacent vertices in the first graph, and their second entries in their ordered pairs, in this case their numbers, are adjacent vertices in the second graph. In our case, consecutive letters or vertices in the first graph are adjacent, and consecutive numbers or vertices in the second graph are adjacent, which means that all strong product vertices with consecutive letters and consecutive numbers will connect to each other. This is exactly the property that a king on a chessboard can move to diagonally adjacent squares on that chessboard. That's it. That's the strong product of two path graphs with 8 vertices each, giving us the 8x8 king's graph. It's pretty neat that the adjacency rules of the strong product and the adjacencies within path graphs allow us to capture the properties of a king's legal moves on a chessboard. To finish the video, let's take a look at some properties of king's graphs. What's the longest shortest path between any two vertices in an n by k king's graph? The answer is the maximum of n and k. Why is this? Well, picture any vertex in an n by k king's graph, in this case an 8x8 king's graph. We can represent each vertex with a set of coordinates where the x coordinate is its column number and the y coordinate is its row number. If we have two vertices and examine their coordinates, we see that their horizontal distance h is the difference of their x coordinates, and their vertical distance v is the difference of their y coordinates. The quickest way to travel between these vertices is to take a diagonal in the direction that decreases both their horizontal and vertical distance at the same time. If we do this for the minimum of hv steps, we get to a position that has either 0 horizontal or 0 vertical distance to our destination vertex, and maximum of hv minus minimum of hv, horizontal or vertical distance remaining to our destination vertex. Think of it as eating into our bigger distance, be it vertical or horizontal, using our smaller distance. Taking these steps, we get that the distance between two vertices in a king's graph with horizontal distance between them h and vertical distance between them v is the minimum of hv plus the maximum of hv minus the minimum of hv. That would just be the maximum of the horizontal and vertical distances. Note that the maximum possible vertical or horizontal distance between vertices is either n or k, whichever is larger. So the maximum of nk is the longest shortest path between any two vertices in an n by k king's graph. What about the size or number of edges of a king's graph? Feel free to pause the video and work this out yourself. If we have an n by k king's graph, then we have n minus 1 times k minus 1 squares in our graph. Each of these squares corresponds to two diagonal edges. That gives us 2 times n minus 1 times k minus 1 diagonal edges. Now we also have the horizontal and vertical edges to count. Notice that if you discard the diagonal edges, what we are left with is a grid. Each column of vertices contains n minus 1 vertical edges, and each row of vertices contains k minus 1 horizontal edges. How many columns are there? K. How many rows are there? N. So that would give us n times k minus 1 plus k times n minus 1 horizontal and vertical edges. Altogether now, we have this expression for the total number of edges in our graph. That's the size of a King's graph. We can simplify this to 4nk minus 3 times n plus k plus 2. Finally, what is the chromatic number of an n by k King's graph? It is 4, as long as the minimum of n and k is greater than 1. This is because as long as the minimum of n and k is greater than 1, there will always be a 4 click, or a set of 4 mutually adjacent vertices in our graph, meaning that the chromatic number is at least 4. We can color any such King's graph in exactly 4 colors like this. Notice that we switched color schemes every row, and within each row we alternated between 2 colors. That's it for this video. In my next video, we'll cover Sperner's lemma, and in the future, we'll come back to some chess-related graphs and other graph operations. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment. Have a great day.